Well, comrades, you will know by now that this is the 100th anniversary since the start of the first great imperialist slaughter, one of the biggest cataclysms in human history. And, of course, naturally, to celebrate, if that's the right word, to celebrate this occasion, we have an outpouring of all kinds of superficial, sentimental nonsense from the so-called experts of the bourgeoisie. First of all, relating to the alleged causes of the First World War. And if you listen to these ladies and gentlemen, pacifists, all of them, of course, how sad, how tragic, how unnecessary, that's the argument that they put forward. What were the causes of the war? Well, for first of all, of course, the assassination of a certain gentleman in a place in the Balkans. That's one argument. I've heard other arguments. For example, the stupidity of the politicians of all sides. The fact that the German Kaiser had a withered left arm. Even the fact that he had a very unhappy childhood and was jealous of his royal cousins in Great Britain. He's seriously put forward with a straight face to explain this cataclysm in which at least 13 million people lost their lives. And of course the conclusion is we're much smarter now than what we used to be, and we learn from history. You know, the German philosopher Hegel, that great thinker, said in his lectures on the philosophy of history, he said the following: anybody that studies history seriously can only come to one conclusion, and that is that nobody has ever learned anything from history, because history constantly repeats itself. It's repeating itself now, as a matter of fact, although I don't know if I'll have much time to deal with the present situation. There are some parallels. There are also, of course, big differences. But frankly, you see, the only way that one can understand the causes of the First World War and how it developed is from a scientific point of view. That is to say, from a Marxist point of view. No other explanation of these events are following. And it's impossible to understand war in general without understanding it from a philosophical point of view, if you like, as a process which develops dialectically. And dialectics teaches us that an accumulation of small, almost imperceptible and gradual changes, contradictions, frictions, tensions, and you see this at all levels of existence, in the universe, from the macrocosm to the microcosm, from the smallest to the greatest, you see the same dialectical process. That a series of small accumulations of contradictions, of changes, reaches at a certain point, which the physicists refer to as a critical point. It reaches a point where quantity becomes transformed into quality, producing an explosion. And it is absolutely useless, let's start by saying, it is useless, it is empty, it is unscientific to approach war or revolutions, because revolutions, after all, are a kind of war, the class war. It is useless to approach that from a moralistic and sentimental point of view, as the pacifists do habitually. Oh, war is terrible, but, you know, there was an occasion, I don't know whether this story is apocryphal or not. It strikes me, it's got the ring of truth about it. During the First World War, some pacifist came up to Lenin and said, "War is terrible." And then looked at him, probably with a withering look, and said, "Yes, terribly profitable. That puts things rather more in context. But you see, on the surface of it, on the surface of it, there was, at the beginning of 1914, right up in maybe till June, war did not seem to be likely. It seemed, as a matter, it seemed to be extremely improbable. So improbable, after all, Britain and Germany were on excellent terms, not just the royal family, because half the crown heads of Europe were descendants of Queen Victoria. I think she must have bred like a rabbit, I don't know. It's true, they were all related. Only yesterday I was reading in a story, I'll put this in an article. The correspondence between the German Kaiser and his cousin in Russia, Tsar Nicholas was his cousin. And the English king, I think, was his uncle. You know, they were all related, all descended from Queen Victoria. An extraordinary exchange of letters. In June and July of 1914, weeks before the war broke out, in which they referred to himself, the German refers to the Russian Tsar as Nicky, dear cousin Nicky. And dear cousin Nicky refers to Kaiser Wilhelm as Willie, with my affectionate best wishes and so on and so forth. This is weeks before the greatest slaughter that history had seen so far. They appeared to be on good terms, such good terms that the Royal Navy, the British Navy, actually visited, made a courtesy visit to the German Navy in the port of, I think it was in Kiel, a few weeks before the war started. They were in such good terms. Britain and Germany actually, and France, were the main trading partners after the USA. They traded with each other. And this, after all, was a long period of prosperity, of calm, except in Russia, where, don't forget, you'd had the Russian Revolution of 1905. But for the rest of Europe, it was a picture of peace, social peace, harmony, economic growth, full employment, relative improvement in living standards. Why? Because this was a period of capitalist expansion, a massive period of capitalist expansion that lasted for some decades, in which everything seemed to be okay. And by the way, I'll deal with this question later. But these objective economic developments, because economics is always at the basis of everything, it doesn't explain everything. You can't reduce everything to economics. That's a stupid vulgarization of Marxism. But yes, economics plays an extremely important role in social and political life. Let's not forget that it was this economic upswing that caused the reformist and nationalist degeneration of the social democracy, of the Labour Party in Britain, of the German Social Democrats, and so on, which is only revealed in the cruelest fashion in the summer of 1914. But on the face of it, everything was fine. Everything was fine. The economy was booming, living standards were increasing, the sun was shining, the birds were singing. Everything was for the best and the best of all possible capitalist worlds, apparently. Apparently. And yet beneath the surface of calm and normality, enormous forces, invisible forces, were building up, which were tending towards an absolute catastrophe. Now, on the question of the causes of the war, this assassination, and by the way, I think it's in 1 week's time, the 28th of June, is the anniversary. When is that? That's in about a week's time. So we'll have to publish an article before then, dealing with this question of the assassination of Franz Ferdinand in Sarajevo. Was that the cause of the war? You see, that assassination comes under the heading of what we would call as Marxist an historical accident. I use the word accident in a philosophical sense. An accident in a philosophical sense is some action or some event which might or might not have occurred. What would have happened, for example, if Gavrilo Princip's revolver misfired? Or he missed his target? Or his victim would have recovered from his wounds? Would that have prevented the First World War? It would not. It would not. This was an accident. But you see, when the processes, which I'll deal with the real causes of the war, when they reach a certain point, as Hegel again, I make no apology for quoting this great genius, Hegel pointed out, necessity expresses itself through accident. If it wasn't one accident, it would have been another accident. One incident, it would have been another incident. But war was absolutely inevitable. At most, the timing would have varied, but the end result would have been absolutely the same. In reality, I'll deal with the Balkan question in a moment. In reality, Austro-Hungary, the Austrian government, was already preparing to attack Serbia before the assassination. All that the assassination did was provide the Austrian military caste, the general staff, with a suitable, convenient excuse to launch an offensive against Serbia, which then brought Russia into the war. France and Britain were later dragged in. That's what caused that was the real process of events. So if you like, the assassination of this individual in Sarajevo was, yes, it was an accident through its necessity expressed itself. It was a catalyst, not a cause, but a catalyst of events which were being prepared. What were these events? Well, I've dealt with the apparent, the surface of things, and everything seemed to be fine. Yes, but what were the underlying tensions? The first element we must look at here is the position of Germany. And most of them say, oh, Germany was responsible for the war. Well, again, even that is not scientific. You can't attribute responsibility for a war by who fired the first shots. This is irrelevant. It is quite possible that you can fire the first shots in a defensive manner. In fact, Germany argued that they were firing shots in a defensive manner against Russia, the Russian threat, as they put it. That's not scientific. So we have to look. The position of Germany was this. Let's not forget, and it's an astonishing thought, if you think about it, it's difficult to grasp. Germany had only existed as an independent United States for about 50 years before the events which I'm describing. Germany was only united in the latter half of the 19th century. And thereafter, German capitalism developed a very powerful industrial base and a military base. It was a highly militarized society, of course, under the domination of Prussia. It won a war, that's another factor. It won a war, an important war against France, the Franco-Prussian War, 1870 to 1871, which ended, as you know, in the Paris Commune. That's a separate discussion. You see there, by the way, how revolution can come out of war. That's partly why it's impermissible for us to adopt a ridiculous pacifist point of view. Wars are necessary. Wars take place in history. They take place at a point when tensions and contradictions between nation states reach such a peak that it's impossible to solve them by peaceful means. The best analysis of war you can read was written not by a Marxist, but somebody that was influenced by Hegel, a very profound military theoretician, Clausewitz. I'm sure that you all know, you haven't read his three volumes on war. Marvelous stuff. It's marvelous stuff because Clausewitz deals with war in a scientific sense, without any sentimentality, any moral judgment. He understood what Hegel understood, and Hegel explained again. Hegel explained, remember about Marx? Hegel explained that historically, and this is perfectly a fact, all serious matters are ultimately determined by force, yes or no. That applies to revolution also. It's impermissible to adopt a sentimental view on this. You think that the ruling class is going to say, oh yes, take over our power and our banks and our land and we will observe democratic, the view of the majority? This is an illusion. No ruling class in history has ever renounced its power and privilege and wealth without a fight. And that usually means a fight with no holds barred. It would be fatal to have any illusions on this. And it's the same thing with war between nations. You know, as Hegel says, ultimately, all serious matters are determined by force. You may weep about it, you may regret it, you may curse it, but it makes no difference. It's a fact. It's a fact of life. It always was a fact of life. And it was here. The good thing about Clausewitz is that he treats war, same as Machiavelli. He's also got a bad name, poor old Machiavelli, another very scientific writer. He analysed state power in the same, you could say, cynical way. I wouldn't say it was cynical. He's describing the question of naked power, naked state power, which ultimately is a question of organised violence. It's a fact. The same way as a Clausewitz approach war. And Clausewitz, if you haven't read the three volumes, you will remember, of course, his famous, immortal aphorism. War, he said, is only the continuation of politics by other means. That's all it is. In other words, it's wrong to think, oh, here you've got peace and the rules apply and so on. And suddenly you've got this madness of, oh, that's the line, isn't it? Oh, war is a collective madness, everyone goes mad. Well, it is, of course. There is madness in war because there's madness in society. Yes, but in the words of Shakespeare, in Hamlet, you know, though this be madness, yet there's method in it. You can explain this madness. It can be explained quite easily. Germany emerged late on the scene. They beat the French. They seized two French provinces, Alsace-Lorraine, which were its two occupied by a partly German-speaking population. That was the argument. That the national question raises its head again. They seized two French provinces, Alsace-Lorraine. That in itself was a sufficient motive for war. The French nation in general, but particularly the French general staff, were seething after this humiliating national defeat. They were seething with a desire for revenge. They were looking for an opportunity to strike, not just to recover Alsace-Lorraine, and we must deal here also with the war aims, the real war aims, not the propaganda about democracy and self-determination and all. That is guff. The real aims of French imperialism was to drive the Germans out of Alsace-Lorraine. Yes, you could say that that was a defensive thing. You could argue that. But also to seize the Rhineland, which is a purely German area, for defensive purposes, and to plunder the German people in revenge, which they did in the monstrous Treaty of Versailles following the First World War, which sowed the seeds for the Second World War. You see how these contradictions can't be resolved under capitalism. German capitalism, if you like to think of it, was suffocating. Here was this mighty industrial base, its enormous potential to produce, but of course, I wasn't present at Rob's surely very important discussion on Marxist capital. But it's not sufficient for the capitalist to produce commodities. You've got to sell them. In order to sell them, you've got to have a market. Great Britain, here's the part. Great Britain, of course, Great Britain, we are led to believe, stood aloof from all this nonsense. They weren't interested in all this business, and Britain were pacifists. They were against war. Yes, they were pacifists, I agree. They were pacifists. Why should they go to war? They had every reason to be pacifists. They wanted to preserve the status quo, a very pleasant status quo for the British imperialists, who just happened to control half the world, that's all. They had in their pocket not just Australia, Canada, New Zealand, but the whole of the wealth of the Indian subcontinent, the enslaved Indian subcontinent, and half of Africa, plus a good chunk of the Caribbean, and for good measure they had a big influence also in many markets in South America and Central America. Not bad, I would say. Not bad at all. So they had no interest whatsoever in changing the status quo. No interest in war, yes. That's the basis of their pacifism. We'll deal a bit more with Britain later on. The French had an interest. The Germans in particular had an interest in breaking the status quo. See, by this time the world was already divided up between older imperialist powers. Not just Britain, which had half the world at its disposal, and the wealth of half the world at its disposal, but France, which had a bigger colonial empire in North Africa, in the Middle East, and in Asia, and even what became known later as poor little Belgium. That was the argument of the British press, you know. The reason for going to war, the reason is to defend the self-determination of poor little Belgium, which is being raped by the Germans. That was the, raped by the Huns. That was the argument. Okay? Yes. Only this, it's true what the Germans did in Belgium was a monstrosity. That's perfectly true. Belgium was raped by German imperialism. But what they forgot to add is this poor little Belgium had under his control millions of colonial slaves in the Congo. Which of all the colonial episodes, the bloodiest, the most, the cruelest, the most monstrous blot on the face of humanity was the Belgian Congo. Don't forget that little detail when you talk about poor little Belgium. Self-determination, okay. What about self-determination for the Congo? They didn't talk about that. What about self-determination for the enslaved peoples of India? British didn't talk about that either. No, self-determination for poor little Belgium. We'll come for the reasons of that, for that in a moment. Even Holland, of course, had enslaved Java, which is now known as Indonesia, and plundered that. So we're dealing here, let's be clear, we're dealing here about a quarrel between robbers. And there's nothing to choose between these robbers. Nothing, what, not a single millimeter separates them. Oh, and I forgot, one of the biggest robbers of all, Tsarist Russia. Tsarist Russia, which Lenin described as the prison house of nationalities. I think that question will be dealt with somewhat tomorrow. Tsarist Russia was the most aggressive, the most ferocious, repressive regime in the world. Here's an interesting idea, by the way, when we come to discuss the Bolshevik Party tomorrow. Just think of the position of the Russian Marxists. A tiny group of people against this monstrous machine, the biggest army in the world, huge police, huge secret police, infiltrating everything. A really ruthless, brutal imperialist regime. The only difference was, as well as the British Empire was spread out all over the terrestrial globe, the Russian Tsarist Empire was one homogenous block which extended from the of enslaved peoples, which extended from the Pacific Ocean to Poland and to the borders of Germany. Bear that in mind. To the frontier of Germany. A permanent threat, therefore, from the national interests of the German bourgeoisie. Russian Tsarism, for decades, had a policy which is described, all these gangsters, to this very day, all these imperialist gangsters, they've always got the best, most humanitarian explanations for their exploits for democracy. The rape of Iraq by the imperialists, you see the results of that, the monstrous results of that action, was justified how? Humanitarianism. Democracy. Some democracy they got out of that episode. But they all those with Tsarist Russia had its own little excuse. Pan-Slavism. Ah, I forgot to mention the other empire, the other great empire which was impinged upon European affairs, that's the Ottoman Empire. It's what's now modern-day Turkey, had a big empire, which occupied the whole of the Middle East, the whole of North Africa, and the Balkans. And the Balkans, which of course were Christian. See how religion's dragged into this question also, you know. And the Tsar of all the Russias put himself forward as the defender of the rights of the Christians on the Balkans against the Turkish oppressors, the Turkish atrocities, so on and so forth. Well, no doubt there were Turkish atrocities. No doubt the Sultan was a tyrant. But what about the tyrant in St. Petersburg, who enslaved millions of people there? That's a separate question. Okay. But beneath this disguise of pan-Slavism, that's to say that the Russians, the Tsarist authorities were going to defend all the Slavs, the Christian Slavs, in the world, put himself as the protector of the oppressed Slavs. The usual nonsense of the imperialists. The Ottoman Empire was in a process of decay. It was collapsing, actually. It was in a very weakened state. And the real war aims of Russia was, of course, to assert Russian control of the Balkans manipulating the Slavs, manipulating the slogan of self-determination. By the way, be very careful about this question of self-determination. The so-called right of self-determination of small nations has habitually and repeatedly been used by imperialist powers as the small change in imperialist policy. The same as the Americans now. They use, for example, the Shiites in Iraq against Saddam Hussein. They use the Kurds in Iraq against Saddam Hussein, only to betray them the following day, stab them in the back and exploit them, plunder them. Be very careful about this. Marx and Engels were implacably opposed to self-determination for the South Slavs. Implacably opposed. They said it was a reactionary movement, unlike the Poles, that was pointed out this morning by Fred. But in the case of the South Slavs, they were implacably opposed. Why? Why? Because they understood that the real reason for this, what lay behind it, was the tentacles of St. Petersburg, Russian agents, and the Russian Tsarist control. That was at stake. Not only that. The war aims of Russia, right throughout the war, the Bolsheviks published it. They published the secret treaties, was to seize Constantinople. Why? In order that the Russian fleet, which was locked into the Black Sea, couldn't have an access to warm waters, which is the Mediterranean. They wanted access to the Mediterranean for their powerful fleet. The British, on the other hand, Christian British, were equally implacably opposed to the disintegration of the Ottoman Empire. They tried to prop the Turks up in order to keep Russia out of the Mediterranean. Why? Don't you understand? Look at the map. Gibraltar, Malta, Cyprus, Egypt. What's the next? Suez Canal. Suez Canal, India. Trade. It was essential for the British to keep the Suez Canal open. And therefore, on the Balkans, they tended to interfere with the Greeks. They wanted to keep Greece under their control and keep Russia out. I'll try to explain, in a few words, the Balkan question. Or as it used to be known in the 19th century, because it's an old question, it used to be known as the Eastern question. The peoples of the Balkans who were enslaved, who were oppressed by the Turks, the Serbs, the Montenegrins, the Bulgarians, the Greeks, and so on, were fighting for national independence. Well, there's nothing wrong with that, of course, against the Turkish yoke, as they put it. Yes, but all the time the Russians were interfering. They were interfering in this. As a result of the, partly of the struggle of the oppressed Slav peoples, the South Slav people. Well, the word Yugoslavia, but it means South Slav, that's what it means. The South Slavs were fighting for their independence. The Russians were backing them even directly with armed force, with military interventions. Finally managed to kick the Turks out. But there was a big chunk of the Balkans that was still under Turkish control at the beginning of the 20th century. Thrace, and in particular Macedonia. Macedonia, by the way, with apologies to the Greek comrades, they don't seem to understand this question. The Macedonians were never Greeks. Alexander the Great was not a Greek. His father was not a Greek. The reason that I can say this, the Greeks referred to him as Philippos or Barbaros, Philip the Barbarian. Barbarians are people who can't speak Greek. That's the meaning of the word. See, they weren't Greeks. But the present-day Macedonians also are not nothing to do with Alexander. They are Slavs who speak a language which is very close to Bulgarian. I can understand Macedonia quite well. It's very close to Bulgarian. So this was still under Turkish control. In 1912, rather, the Russian diplomacy scored a big hit when they succeeded in cobbling together what they called the Balkan League, which is an alliance composed of Serbia, Bulgaria, which is practically independent, Serbia, Bulgaria, Montenegro, and Greece, okay, for war against the Turks in order to liberate Macedonia. That was the argument. This is the explanation of what's known as the Balkan Wars. Trotsky went to the Balkans. He wrote a very interesting book about the Balkan Wars. He was there as a war correspondent. It's quite interesting. It started with the war. There were two Balkan Wars. One in 1912, which I suppose you could say had a semi-progressive content. I mean, you couldn't oppose the emancipation of Macedonia from the Turkish oppression. But there was a second war. They beat the Turks. The Bulgarians played the biggest role in that. They really did most of the fighting and inflicted a heavy defeat on Turkey. The Serbs and the Greeks held back. They weren't quite so prominent. But no sooner had they succeeded in doing this, and I draw your attention to this fact, we're talking about the national question this morning. There is nothing that says that a formerly oppressed small nation, oppressed by imperialism, colony if you like, cannot be transformed into a vicious small imperialist state. That's completely undialectical. It was cited this morning. America itself used to be a colony of Britain, don't forget, and it became transformed into the most monstrous imperialist power. And on the Balkans, you see this. I've got a personal experience. I lived on the Balkans for some time. I got personal experience of this. Of course, in every Balkan state, they write monstrous textbooks, the most vicious nationalism and chauvinism you could possibly imagine, both poison and hatred, direct against the others, you know, Serbs against Bulgarians, Bulgarians against Greeks, and so on. All tell lies about the past. They're all victims, all playing about. And every single one of them, as soon as they were emancipated from Turkish control, became vicious, voracious, greedy, small imperialisms, if you like, regional imperialism, trying to grab the territory of the others. That was the cause of the Second Balkan War. Greece and Serbia joined together, they ganged together behind the backs of Bulgaria, they stabbed the Bulgarians in the back. They promised the Bulgarians that after the Congress they'd get most of Macedonia, which I suppose is fair enough, as there's not much difference between those two peoples, at that time at least. And the Bulgarians had done most of the fighting. As soon as it was over, they stabbed Bulgaria in the back. War was declared. They wanted to grab a large part of what was supposed to be Bulgarian territory, which they did. The Serbs grabbed a big chunk of Macedonia. The Romanians, like jackals who played no role in the struggle against the Turks, invaded in the north and seized Dobruja. The Greeks seized Salonika, which was not a Greek city at all. It was a mixed city of Macedonians, some Greeks, Armenians, Jews. A lot of Jews were there. They seized that and turned it into a Greek province. And by the way, every single one of these nations systematically oppress other people. They oppress the Greeks forced a policy of Hellenization on the Macedonians, brutally. Forced them to speak Greek and so on. The Bulgarians did the same thing with Greeks. You know, and the Albanians, they all did the same. There was nothing to choose. But it was the most monstrous reactionary. Well, there was nothing to choose. It makes me cringe nowadays when I see so-called Marxists, so-called Trotskyists even. It seems the moment that some war breaks out between different groups of gangsters, they immediately, oh, we've got to take some. Who do you support? Like in the case of Yugoslavia. Who do you support? The Croats? The Serbs? Self-determination? Long live self-determination. They shout, you know, as if Lenin never wrote anything on the subject. Lenin explained a million times that the right to self-determination is a democratic right, which we support, same as we support the right to divorce or abortion, as was stated this morning. Yes, but Marx explained, never mind about Lenin, Marx explained, and Lenin explained that the right to self-determination is not absolute. Can never be absolute. And it is always subordinate to what Marx said, the labor question, the worker question. It's always subordinate to the general interest of the world revolution in particular. And we're under no particular obligation to support different national cliques to seize territories of other national cliques. There wasn't an atom of progressive content in that. In the end, of course, the Bulgarians were outnumbered. They were weakened because they'd done the brunt of the fighting. And they were smashed. And the neighboring countries, Serbia in particular, seized a big part of Bulgarian territory. Another cause for the First World War. The feeling of outrage, of national humiliation, of revenge on the part of the Bulgarians, again, was to play a fatal role. The Bulgarians later joined the Central Powers, that is to say Austria and Germany, to attack Serbia. Also perpetrating atrocities leading to terrible human misery and so on. I repeat, there is nothing whatsoever that obliges Marxists to automatically support the so-called right of self-determination where these nations are perpetrating reactionary policies, as was the case recently in Yugoslavia. But to go back to the scenario, Serbia emerged strengthened from this, of course. When I say Serbia, I'm referring to the Serb bourgeoisie, the ruling circle of Serbia, a vicious, militaristic, expansionist, aggressive bourgeoisie, the same as all the others. Nothing to choose. The Greeks were the same. The Bulgarians were the same. Nothing to choose between them. But Serbia definitely became a major force. This brought it into conflict with Austro-Hungary, another empire in the process of disintegration, which had a base in the Balkans, which considered the Balkans to be their backyard, to be their private property. And therefore, what you have here, what you had in the Balkan Wars even, was like a proxy war between Tsarist Russia on the one hand and Austro-Hungary on the other hand for the control of the Balkans. In 1908, the Austrians made a move because there was a power struggle in Constantinople at the time. They seized, they annexed Bosnia-Herzegovina, which is a province. They speak Serb, there's different, it's a mixture there, but they speak the same language. I think Fred explained that this morning. And of course, this brought them into collision with the Serbs. The Serbs considered Bosnia to be theirs. They had, I suppose, every right to say that. They considered it to be their property. There was a collision there. What I'm describing here, if you think, are a series of fault lines, like geological fault lines, where an earthquake sooner or later is bound to erupt. It could be on one day, it could be in another day, but it's bound to erupt at a certain stage. So the fault line between the Serbs, the expansionist Serb bourgeoisie, and the decrepit Austrian Empire, that was a racing certainty. So this brings us up to the events of June 1914. To this day, I can't really understand the mechanism or the reasons for this. It seems surreal. It seems surreal that the crown prince, the heir to the Habsburg dynasty, Franz Ferdinand, who seemed to be a bit of an idiot, but there you are, insisted on going personally to Bosnia, to Sarajevo, of all places, this place seething with nationalist discontent, with intrigues, with terrorism, because there were terrorist groups, of which one member was a young man, Serb, a Bosnian Serb, Gavrilo Princip. He went there in his full dress uniform with his plumed hat and so on. What the hell he was expecting there, I don't know. Could only expect an assassin to pull it, that's all. But he went there. No security precautions, it just staggers me. They even published in the press the itinerary where his carriage was going to go, which the terrorists read with great interest, as you can imagine. Now the Serbs, let's be clear, terrorism is a weapon which is always used by the weak against the strong. And terrorism was used by the Serb regime. There's no argument about that. The police chief, I've forgotten his name, the head of the military and the secret service, they had the equivalent of Al-Qaeda or something like that, you know. The Black Hand, I think it was called, to make it sufficiently dramatic, for the purpose of, yes, of planting bombs and robbing banks and bumping people off, and other similar agreeable hobbies. There was a group like this, it was called a Young Bosnia, they were Bosnians actually, Young Bosnia, Mlada Bosna, in the Serb language. A member of this was a young chap, I don't know how old was he, 18, 19, I can't remember, youngster, Gavrilo Princip, he's now a hero in Serbia, you know. They planned to assassinate the Austrian crown prince. Naturally, what would you do? Naturally. And, of course, the plot nearly failed, by the way. That's what I'm saying. It was an accident. It might have happened, might not have happened. Because there were a group of them. The first one lobbed a bomb at the royal carriage. It failed, although his wife had got a face cut. So that's, one would have thought that was a sufficient warning, you know. Chap throws a bomb at my car, I'm off. They were bombed at the car. The woman was in, the Duchess was injured, the blood was on her dress and so on. And this idiot, Franz Ferdinand, instead of going into hiding or getting the first express plane back to Vienna, decides that he's a big man, he's going to show himself in public and he's going to show he's not afraid. Not afraid. Well, perhaps he wasn't afraid, but he was certainly dead. He came out. The role of accident in history, even the car, there was an accident. The car took a wrong turning. The carriage, rather, took a wrong turning, went on the wrong street. It was then backing up. I don't know if it was a carriage, it might have been a car. I think it was a car. It was backing up, and it seemed, where, by accident, Gabriel Prince happened to be standing outside a cafe. And he said, "Thank you, Lord. This is my day." Having a pistol in his pocket, he went up and shot them both. I think he probably killed the woman by accident, but they were both stone dead anyway. He was caught, as you can imagine, roughed up quite a bit. He was too young to be executed under Austrian law, and therefore they, like Christian gentlemen, they buried him alive. They put him in an Austrian fortress in solitary confinement, without access to books or writing, where he died of tuberculosis in, I think, 1918. He scrawled on the wall of his cell, you know, that we will be remembered, we will be remembered and we'll be avenged on the lords of society, or words to that effect. But that's to one side. These are accidents. Because all that that event did, of course, you think the Austrian general staff were displeased, they were rubbing their hands. Terrorism always plays a reaction. It's a reactionary thing. They had every excuse that they needed to come down on Serbia like a ton of bricks. They were looking for a chance to declare war on Serbia. What better chance than this? They stirred up war hysteria, mass patriotic demonstrations, of course. Nothing simpler to mold public opinion in that particular way at the beginning of a war. I want to deal with the events in detail. To cut a long story short, Austria, when they declare war on Serbia, Austria was allied with Germany. There was a triple alliance formed before 1914, three powers, Germany, Austria, and Italy. You had the German Hungary wolf. You had the weakened Austria, and then you had the little yapping Italian jackal. The conduct of the Italian, Italy was only united about the same time as Germany. They had no colonies to dispute. They wanted colonies. I think they thought they wanted to be the Roman Empire or something. Mussolini showed that later on. Yes, but they were impotent, really, you know. And what they lacked in power, they made up in cunning. Sneaking around, like haggling, how much are you going to give me? This is how diplomacy works. What are you going to give us? What are you going to give us? We want so-and-so. We want a slice of Dalmatia. We want Albania. We want this. We want these ports in the north of... But what are you going to give me? Finally, it seems the Germans and Austrians offered them a bit more, so they joined them. A bit like a pimp. He's pimping for trade, you know, for customs. Well, the Triple Alliance was formed. The French and Russians, therefore, in response, formed their own alliance. Russia, this is on both sides of Germany, by the way. France is on the west, Russia is on the east. By the way, they're all arming to the teeth. For decades before this, they're arming to the teeth. The Germans in particular, and here we'll deal a little bit with Great Britain, mustn't forget the pacifist Britain. They were all arming to the teeth. The Germans began to build up their navy. This is a big threat to Britain. Now, what you must think of, this is a question for you. How does it come about that a tiny little island like this comes to conquer and be the masters of half the world? How? How is it done? Well, one of the methods which they perfected, Fred mentioned it this morning, was the tactic of divide and rule. They were very skillful at that. India was conquered by Indian troops, not by British troops. They had Indian troops to do the fighting for them. Divide and rule. And on the continent of Europe, the tactic was to keep Europe divided and weak, which they referred to as the balance of power. You've heard of the balance of power? So that one country must never dominate Europe because that'd be a threat to British interests. Now, Britain, you may have noticed, is a bit different to other European countries. What's the difference? You haven't noticed? We are an island, my friends. We are surrounded by masses and masses of H2O, you know. Saline water surrounds us. This is an important protection. Therefore, the British bourgeoisie, unlike the French, the Germans, and the other countries, never had to maintain a big standing army, which is a big cost. Never had the same bureaucratic regime as in the continent. It was relatively democratic as part of the reason for it. Okay? But the Navy, that's another matter. The British Navy was the key, and therefore they had a policy up until quite a few years after the First World War. The policy was the British Navy must always be stronger than the two combined navies of the next most powerful nations. For example, the British Navy must be bigger than the German and French fleet combined. And it was. Therefore, when Germany began to develop a powerful fleet, this was a threat. This was a serious threat. And this brings us to poor little Belgium. The British declared war against Germany because the Germans invaded Belgium, anticipating a little bit. Why was Belgium so important? For God's sake, it's a petty little country, it's of no importance. And so what's the... It is important. Think of the geography of it. Think of the strategic question. Whoever controls the ports of Belgium is a threat to the British ports. Is a threat to the British Navy. Therefore, Belgium independence was a fundamental basis of British military and foreign policy. They couldn't tolerate any messing around with Belgium. So what occurred? What is the concatenation of events? Here we have the Austrians want to attack Serbia. They consult the big brother in Berlin, the man with the withered arm, Kaiser Bill, Willy. And Willy says, great, go and get him. We'll back you. He even sent what amounts to a blank check. We'll back you, don't worry, we'll back you. Some of the Germans were not very happy about this, but anyway, he decided anyway. Problem. Serbia is not a problem, but Serbia's also got a big brother. Guess who? Russia. Hence the exchange of, not emails, but the exchange of telegrams between cousin Willie with cousin Nicky to try and sort things out. No, it was too late. It was too late. The impetus towards war, these fault lines have already acquired a dynamic of its own. Unstoppable now. That the Russians, seeing the attack of the Serbs, were attacked brutally by the Austrian army. Russia began to mobilize. There was a bit of confusion about the actual, whether it was going to be partial mobilization or full mobilization. It doesn't matter. I won't go into the details. For the German general staff, this was it. You think the German general staff was upset because the Russians were mobilizing? No, they were rubbing their hands. Just what they wanted. They wanted war with Russia. Why did they want war with it? Because Russia was in the process of reforming its army after the humiliating defeat which they suffered against Japan in 1904. They were reforming their army. This was a danger to Germany. Therefore, the argument of the general staff was quite simple. They said to Kaiser, look, Your Majesty, either we attack Russia now, or else if we wait in a few years' time, they'll have a powerful military machine which will be a threat to us. So, let the Russians mobilize. We'll mobilize as well. France, of course, seeing the situation, says, okay, you're mobilizing your army, we're mobilizing our army. And therefore, the whole thing was moving in this direction. Now, I've dealt with the economic question that Germany was suffocating for lack of markets and so on and so forth. That's at the roots of it. I've dealt with other questions, the Balkans, the conspiracy of Tsarism and so on. The colonial policy, the desire to seize colonies, Germany didn't have any. A couple of miserable little, the poorest countries in Africa. Tanganyika, Uganda, I don't know what else, Namibia, yeah. Didn't suit them. But there was another reason which might interest you. Fear of revolution. That particularly goes for Russia. Fear of revolution was a factor, no question about it. In June or July, I can't remember, July I think it was, 1914, the French president, in the middle of all this mess on the Balkans, the French president, Poincaré, visits St. Petersburg for a talk to Nicky, cousin Nicky. What are your intentions? Are you going to fight? I think you should fight, and this kind of thing. What does Poincaré see? And he was horrified, he was amazed. In the streets of St. Petersburg, in the summer of 1914, he sees red flags, mass workers' demonstrations, barricades, fights with the police and the Cossacks. Russia was moving at that time in the direction of revolution. It had recovered from the defeat of 1906, recovered from the period of reaction, and from 1912 to 1914, it was an upswing in which the Bolshevik Party, for the first time, stood at the head of the movement. You know, this was undoubtedly a factor. Russia was moving in the direction of revolution in 1914. That was a big factor in the calculations of Tsarism when they declared war against Germany, which they did, which sparked the whole thing off the Germans. In order to protect their flank, the French had a powerful defensive line, as they thought they had in 1939 also. The Germans attacked Belgium, through Belgium, which immediately brought Britain into play. By the way, the British Foreign Minister, Sir Edward Grey, not a stupid man, he's made out to be stupid, he wasn't all that stupid, his policy had a certain logic, said the following. He said, look, if we go to war, at the end of the war, the Labour will be in power everywhere, referring to the working class. And you can see the danger of revolution arising out of the... At that time, by the way, the British were more concerned with Ireland, which was on the brink of civil war. And the class struggle in this country was reaching a peak. Churchill, the Home Minister, sent the army into South Wales. Tonopandy, wasn't it? Comrade, I think you remember that, yeah? You were there at the time, I believe. Churchill sent the army against the Welsh miners, and people were killed. And so on. So the class struggle was developing in Europe, but particularly for Russia, this was a major question. And by mobilizing, by declaring war and mobilizing, they cut across that. Some people ask, well, how is it possible for workers to be so deceived? Why did they suddenly fall for this patriotic stuff? It's very easy, as a matter of fact. Nothing easier when the ruling class has in its hands all the means of moulding public opinion. Of course, they don't have the means that they have now. But they had the press, certainly, the pulpit, the church, the politicians, all the establishment, and so on, mobilizing to rouse a pitch of patriotic fever in all countries. And it worked. In Russia, the ground was cut from under the feet of the Bolshevik Party and the revolution. The youth were mobilized into the army, where they were swamped in a sea of backward peasants. The workers were swamped. For every one worker in the trenches, you'd have 100 or more backward, illiterate, politically ignorant peasants. Therefore, that explains, by the way, the Bolsheviks were in a minority at the beginning of the revolution in 1917. It's a big factor. Trotsky explains that. However, you see, the question is this. Historically speaking, it frequently occurs that wars produce revolution, or produce revolutionaries at a certain stage. The same patriotic flag-waving soldiers that marched to the front in this country later became communists and revolutionaries, including my own family. That's why I'm here today. My grandfather, George Woods, was a young tin plate worker in Swansea, steel worker. I don't think he was particularly political. He must have been very young at the time. Don't forget, the British people didn't know what war was. That's a big factor. They didn't know what it was. There's only been one war, basically, in the recent period. That was the Boer War, which was an easy victory. It wasn't a problem. And therefore, it seemed like an adventure. Imagine the life of a young worker with a life of drudgery, of misery, of bad conditions in work, poor pay, and so on, stuck in, no chance of any advancement or any of getting out of this drudgery. The prospect of joining the glorious British Army and going to fight the Huns in France and so on, it would have been irresistible for many. Many people flocked to the flag. They joined. My grandfather volunteered in September 1914. I've got his military record at home. He volunteered for the British Army. He fought in France till 1919. I don't know, in artillery. I don't know how he survived. He was gassed, it's true. He suffered a chest problem, but he wasn't killed, which is also why I'm here. But my mother must have been, my mother was born at the same time as the Russian Revolution in 1917, in November 1917. He must have been on leave at the time, you know, from France. But anyway, he came out of that. I never got him to talk about the First War. We'd never talk about the war. None of my family would talk about the war. Nothing. Nothing, not a word. He became a communist, a militant communist, like thousands of others. The South Wales Miners Union joined the Communist International, as did the Clydeside shop stewards in Glasgow. They joined the Communist International also. And of course, as far as Russia is concerned, just look at dialectics, my friends. That's what it means, dialectics. If you were a revolutionary in 1914, you might be excused, if you weren't a trained revolutionary, for being slightly pessimistic. The whole thing has collapsed. The censorship and the dictatorship is in full swing. Lenin had to flee, I think, for the third or fourth time. Third or fourth, I can't remember. What was it, Rob? Third time, was it? Fourth time, I can't remember. Into exile, into Switzerland, where he was completely and absolutely isolated for the whole of the war. You see, I want you to think about this. Now, I know this is what I'm going to say is going to sound extraordinary and impossible to you, youngsters, because I see you with your smartphones and your laptops and all kinds of this wizardry, which I don't pretend to understand, you know, and you're permanently connected to the ends of the earth. You see, Lenin actually didn't possess a smartphone. Nor was he connected to internet. He was stuck in Switzerland. The only way you could get established contact with Russia was by post. You understand what that means? Post crossing Europe, which is divided by dictatorships and the military rule. Workers of the world unite, and here are the workers slaughtering each other, bayoneting each other, gassing each other to death. Okay. It would sound like a cruel irony to even talk about internationalism under these. And the worst thing of all, was the role of the leaders of the working class, the leaders of the social democracy who talked to make big speeches on the 1st of May about working class internationalism and the class struggle and revolution and the dictatorship of the proletariat. Every single one of them, starting with the Germans, who were the heads of the international, in the moment of truth, betrayed the working class, supported the war credits. This is known to you now, but you don't understand. You really don't understand what that meant to every single militant worker, every single person in the world, that these great leaders betrayed, that they support the war, with two exceptions, the Russians and the Serbs. I won't mention the Irish because they weren't a separate nation at that time, but the Irish and the Russians and the Serbs, the rest of them voted for the war credits. Such was the psychological blow which this deed meant, that when Lenin received a copy of the German Social Democratic newspaper, the Vorwärts, saying that they had 111 members of parliament in Germany, it's a mass force, that they supported the war credits, he didn't believe it. He said, no, this cannot be. This is a forgery of the German general staff to discredit us. But once Lenin understood that it was true, he did not hesitate. He did not vacillate. He immediately said, this is it, finished. The Second International is finished forever as a revolutionary force. Rosa Luxemburg in Germany said the same thing. She said, it's a stinking corpse. And we need a new international, a communist international. Which he put forth that idea, even though he was isolated, representing far less than what we represent now, by the way, in far worse conditions. People forget that. In 1915, Europe is submerged in this dance of death, this macabre dance of death. Lenin and a few others organized the Zimmerwald Conference, and it's next year's the anniversary, we must celebrate that, in the small Swiss village. And when Lenin looked around the room, at the pathetic few people present, far less than what I hear today, he cracked it. He made a joke. He had a sense of humor then, but it was a serious joke. He said, well, comrades, it seems that you can get all the revolutionaries, all the internationalists in the world into two stagecoaches. That was the fact, tiny numbers of isolated people. So bad was the situation that Lenin, in January 19, and he was an optimist, Lenin, he was an incorrigible optimist, as I hope we all are. In January 1917, he was speaking to a meeting of Swiss young socialists, as I'm speaking to you now. And he said the following, he said, well, I'm an old man. He said, it wasn't true, he was younger than me, but that's what he said anyway. I'm an old man, he said, and I probably will never live to see the socialist revolution. He said, it's up to you, it's up to the young people to carry things forward, you know. That's what he said. A couple of weeks later, the Tsar was overthrown by the same Russian workers and peasants in uniform that had been patriotic and carrying flags and so on in 1940. Those who were still left alive, that is. People learn, you see. The class learns, maybe slowly, maybe with great difficulty, with great pain and so on, great sad, but they learn, they do learn. And eventually they come to the correct conclusions. The Tsar was overthrown a few weeks after he made that speech. 9 months later, Lenin and Trotsky were in power. In the Russian Revolution, which was a beacon to the whole world, which finished the war and began to carry through the Socialist Revolution. But that, of course, is another episode. That's another subject. Comrades, I'm painfully aware that I haven't dealt in much detail as I would have liked, but this is a huge subject. I hope at least with this short lecture to have aroused your interest in the subject. We must continue this. I promise, I pledge myself to produce a series of articles. Perhaps we can put them together later as a book, I don't know. Dealing with the whole history of the First World War. Blow by blow, explaining the war aims of each of the countries. I haven't dealt with that in any detail. Exposing all the lies of the imperialists. And above all, yes, and this is the main thing that we must always bear in mind. That even when, you see, it reminds me of Galileo Galilei, this great man when he was threatened with torture by the Inquisition and forced to relinquish his ideas and forced to say that the planets don't move. On his deathbed, he said in Italian, "E pur si muove," and yet it moves. And yet it moves. It does move. I say the same thing about the working class. Although it's, at times it seems to be slow, the position seems to be difficult, we see all the problems of the world. Our problems, my friends, are nothing compared to the problems and the difficult situation faced by Lenin in those dark days of the First World War. And yet out of that nightmare, out of that darkness, came the first proletarian revolution in history, in world history. That is a lesson which we must bear in mind. These events are not unique. They will be repeated, as was stated in the previous session. There will be another May 1968. Only this time, comrades, this time, we must be prepared. We must be in a sufficiently strong position to provide what is required, which can be summed up in one word and one word alone, leadership, to provide the necessary leadership to the instinctive movement of the working class for socialism, and that alone is the recipe for our final victory.